So friends, we learn about audit evidence. Audit evidences are just now, before some time we are discussing. They are important because on the basis of audit evidences, an auditor will be able to form an opinion on the financial statements. What auditor actually does? Auditor collects evidences by applying various audit procedures. You already know various kinds of audit procedures. Today again, we'll be discussing some of the audit procedures. In fact, audit program contains various audit procedures. You have already seen how programs are prepared, how audit strategy is prepared, how audit planning is done, all this concept you're aware of. So by applying those audit procedures, auditor collects certain evidences, auditor evaluates those evidences and forms an opinion, right? Normally, audit program is designed in a such a way that it will be helping the auditor to collect audit evidences. Okay, just we are talking earlier that suppose you want to verify the bank balance, you may be requiring a banker certificate, you may be requiring bank passbook or bank statement, you might be requiring, bank reconciliation statement. On the basis of all these documents, you will be able to form an opinion whether the bank balance is showing a true and fair view or not. Is it not? Similarly, let us say you want to verify whether this much of money has been paid as tax or not. So you might be looking for a payment challan. On the basis of that, you will be able to form an opinion whether this tax has been properly paid or not. Suppose you want to verify whether the position of the debtor is correct or not, debtor amount is correct or not. So you may review the sales ledger, right? You may review the sale bills. On that basis, you'll be able to form an opinion whether the debtor balance is correct or not. Let us say you want to give an opinion whether the inventory figures which are shown in the financial statement are correct or not, that showing the true and fair view or not. Then what you can do, you may go for a physical verification, right? That physical verification report is an audit evidence. So like that, there are various forms of audit evidences. You'll be learning some of the evidences might be, documentary evidences. Sometimes we collect through observation also, we collect some evidences, right? So there are various forms in which evidences are collected. Evidences are extremely important because on that basis, entire audit opinion needs to be formed. So let us start discussing that topic. Of course, at a concept level earlier also we had discussed it. Now quickly, we'll learn it in little detail. I think screen is visible to you now. Let me first take you to SA 500. Okay, Standards on Auditing 500. This deals with audit evidences. It explains what constitutes audit evidences. First of all, if you read this particular standard, you will see it is explaining the items which constitute audit evidences in an audit of financial statement. And that particular standard also deals with auditor's responsibility to design and perform audit procedures to obtain audit evidences, to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidences, to be able to draw reasonable conclusions on which to base the auditor's opinion. So if you read this particular paragraph, you can understand why audit evidences are required. It is required because auditor has to draw a conclusion. Conclusion means whether this financial statement is showing true and fair view. And that conclusion has to be based on audit evidences. And audit evidences should be sufficient as well as appropriate. That should be sufficient audit evidences. Let us say, this 100 debtor includes 5,000 parties and you have only tested 3 parties. On that basis, can you form an opinion that the front, that 100 debtor figure is true and correct, true and fair? What do you say? Can you form an opinion? There are 5,000 parties and you have only verified the balances of 3 parties. Can you say it is true and fair on that basis? Yes or no? Whether we'll say it is giving true and fair view or not? Yes or no? So naturally, you'll feel that you might have collected some audit evidences, but that evidences is not sufficient. It might be appropriate. but it is not sufficient. So when an auditor forms her opinion, he has to see two aspects, whether this evidence is on the basis of which conclusion is drawn, they are sufficient or appropriate. Then how an auditor will be able to collect audit evidences? What is required? He has to apply audit procedures. And auditors should design audit procedures in such a way that sufficient appropriate audit evidences are collected. And this standard says it is the responsibility of the auditor to design and perform audit procedures. Right? What constitutes audit evidences? That has been explained. As well as the responsibility of collecting audit evidences is also fixed. So this is about some elements of SF item. Okay. Now if you try to understand what is the meaning of audit evidences, that has also been defined. It is defined as the information used by the auditor in arriving at the conclusions on which auditor's opinion is based. So any information which is used by the auditor in arriving at the conclusions can be referred to as audit evidence. Okay. And it is not necessary that audit evidences means only accounting records. There might be accounting records, non-accounting records also. Okay, maybe something may be related, or something might be relevant to the accounting records. That is also relevant for us. For example, let us say you are saying the salary payment has been made. So that can be cross-checked with attendance register. Attendance register may be a non-accounting record, but that may form a part of audit evidence. Is it? So like this, so audit evidences includes accounting records. It also includes many other information. It's not necessary that only accounting records constitute an audit evidence. Correct. Okay. When coming to accounting records are important. And accounting records includes many things. For example, record of initial entries, accounting entries. That means maybe in different organization you find that vouchers are prepared. Vouchers are prepared or vouchers are entered into the system. So you can say that is the point where basic accounting is made. That is the initial record of accounting entries. Invoices. Invoices means bills. So for all sales transactions, bills needs to be raised. So invoices also forms a part of accounting record. On that basis, let us say, company's revenue can be verified. Contracts. Contracts also forms a part of accounting record. With reference to the contracts, one can find out the obligation of the entity, the liabilities of the entity. Accordingly, provisions can be made. Directly, it may not form a part of accounting records, but this is something, contracts are also related to accounting record. Then subsidiary ledgers, general ledger and subsidiary ledger. General ledger is the main ledger. Subsidiary ledger means you can say they are the sub ledgers. Let us say there is one general ledger, sundry debtors, but there are various parties. Each party, all the parties taken together, let us say company might be maintaining a subsidiary ledger. So subsidiary ledgers and general ledgers, they are also forms a part of accounting records. All these things constitute part of audit evidence. Records such as worksheets. Many times for many calculations, worksheets are used. There is the interest calculation. There might be a separate worksheet with reference to, by using which interest are computed. So various computations, let us say depreciation computation sheet, bank reconciliation sheet, all these things are accounting records, which are very much helpful to draw conclusions. Or you can say they also form a part of audit evidences. Are you getting me? Hope you have understood what is the meaning of accounting records. And when I say not only accounting records, other records are also included in audit evidences. We can take some examples of other information. For example, minutes of board meeting. That is definitely not an accounting record. So board minutes are also helpful because they also provide evidence whether a particular decision has been taken or not. But they also justify some of the transactions, financial transactions. And with reference to that, one also can assess asset position and the liability position of an entity. Sometimes written confirmations are also asked from debtors. They are also a part of non-accounting information. They are not generated through accounting process. But parties are asked to confirm whether the balance is right or wrong. So on, they also forms a part of, you can say, non-accounting record. And various manuals, guidelines, which are basically developed as a part of internal control system. So they also forms a part of audit evidences. They show what is the process which needs to be followed for a particular transactions. So whether they're followed or not, that can be tested. Okay, are you getting me? Okay, when I talk about audit evidence, we mean the combination of both, meaning some accounting records and some non-accounting records. All taken together will constitute an audit evidence. Right, in any audit situation, the auditor plans and he designs the audit procedures. He designs the audit program in such a way that it includes many audit procedures. And through these procedures, as you know, auditor collects audit evidences. So objective of auditor is to design and perform audit procedures in such a way as to enable the auditor to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence to be able to draw reasonable conclusions on which to base his auditor's opinion. Again, I repeat, ultimately auditor has to give his opinion. But that opinion has to be based on certain conclusions. The conclusions has to be drawn with reference to audit evidence. Right. So therefore, auditor needs to design audit procedures in such a way that audit evidences can be collected. I think you have understood up to this. Now, relating to audit evidences, one connected topic we need to discuss, that is information from experts. Sometimes what happens, the organization uses experts' opinion. Let us say organization has arrived at fair value of an asset. The organization or the entity might have contacted a valuer. On the basis of his opinion, he might have disclosed the fair value of an asset. Now, auditor has to comment on that. Right. So here, what kind of care auditor is expected to take? Now, we'll be learning that. When information to be used as audit evidences has been prepared by using the work of management experts, what the auditor do? Auditors shall, to the extent necessary, having regard to the significance of experts' work for the auditor's purpose, what auditor will do? Evaluate the competence, capability, and objectivity of the expert. Let us say the example I give you. Let us say entity has taken a report from a valuer that the fair value of this property is this. Here, what the auditor will do? Auditor will evaluate the competence, capability, and objectivity of the expert. Whether the expert is competent to give that report, is competent to do the valuation of that asset, and what is his capability, and whether he has objectively evaluated that. Okay, so these evaluations has to be made by the auditor. Auditor has to evaluate the competence, capability, and objectivity of the expert. Also, auditor need to obtain an understanding of the work of the expert. Auditor may go through the report, try to understand the how the expert has arrived at that. Also, auditor is supposed to evaluate the appropriateness of expert's work as audit evidence for the relevant assessments. Whether this expert's work is appropriate, let us say auditor is testing certain assessments. You already know what are the assessments. Let us say for assets, non-current asset, auditor is testing about existence of the asset. For existence of the asset, maybe expert opinion may not be helped. That is inappropriate. Whether asset is existing or not, then auditor may go for a physical verification. Is it not? But for measurement of the value, then okay, expert opinion is relevant. So expert's opinion is appropriate. So auditor has to check and auditor needs to evaluate the appropriateness of expert's work as audit evidence. Okay, so for different kind of assessments, maybe different kind of audit evidence is required. Okay, on that basis, auditor need to evaluate the expert work when expert's work is involved. I think you have understood this. Okay, now as regards to certain information which is produced by the entity, auditor also need to do certain things. When information is produced by the entity, the auditor first of all is expected to evaluate whether that is reliable or not. Right? How we can test? You would definitely like to collect some audit evidences about the accuracy and completeness of the information. Right? Let us say auditor has asked for, give me your Sunday debtors list. Entity has given the list of Sunday debtors. Auditor may check whether that is matching with the financial statement which is prepared. If that is not matched, then it is not complete. Something is missing. Is it? And about the accuracy. Accuracy also can be tested. Maybe that list can be compared with one individual ledger. One can find out whether that shows accuracy or not. Or auditor may ask balance confirmation certificate from certain debtors. And he can match the figures which are mentioned in the balance confirmation certificate with the list which is provided by the management. So through this kind of processes, auditor will be able to draw a conclusion whether this information which is produced by entity are reliable or not. Auditor also is supposed to evaluate whether the information is sufficiently precise and detailed for auditor's purpose. What information auditor is required, precisely whether all the information is provided to him or not. That also auditor is supposed to evaluate. Okay, auditor might be requiring certain things in detail. Okay, so the detailed calculations are available or not. Auditor should test that thing. Auditor should evaluate whether the information are available, that is enough or not. Right? Now, friends, sometimes what happens? When auditor collects evidences, it finds there is inconsistencies between two sources of information or between information collected from two sources. Right? Maybe, just like very simple example, you can see maybe your bank ledger is showing a figure, bank statement is showing different figure. So that's why you are going for an evidence. You are going for a reconciliation, which is an audit evidence. You see, if reconciliation is made, then you can say that's fine. The figures are, let us say, reliable. If reconciliation is not possible, reconciliation or the figures are not reconciled, then definitely there is something wrong. Is it that? So when auditor sees there are inconsistencies between, let us say, one source of information and another source of information, then it is natural that auditor gets a doubt. Is it that? Auditor has a doubt on reliability of the information which is collected. In that situation, what is expected from an auditor? He might have to modify the audit procedure, or he might have to follow some additional procedures so that some additional evidences can be collected. And on the basis of those additional evidences, or by applying these additional procedures, this matter needs to be resolved. Okay, so either auditor may confirm his doubt or may dispel his doubt. These are the two possibilities. Right. Okay, so in case any inconsistency, auditor is expected to do this. Now, we'll discuss two more concepts, which you broadly know. This is about sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidence. As you already know, sufficiency means we are talking about quantity. And appropriateness means we are talking about relevance. And what is expected? Auditor is expected to design and perform audit procedures that are appropriate in the circumstances for the purpose of obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. So audit procedures should be designed in such a way that it will give the auditor sufficient evidence as well as appropriate evidence. Right. So depending upon the facts and circumstances, auditor has to plan, auditor has to design the audit procedures. Auditor has to think which procedures is going to give me sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. And it is necessary to have audit evidences, because without that you cannot form an opinion. Right? And when I say audit evidences, it is not necessary that audit evidences has to be collected only from the, let us say, entity. It may be collected from other sources and from outsiders also. Right, audit evidences may be collected from outsiders or from any other external sources. It can be collected from the entity's accounting records. Maybe it is collected from non-accounting records. It may be collected from outsources. Sometimes evidences might be, entity might have collected some evidences from experts. These experts' opinions can be helpful. Right? And audit evidences comprises both information that supports and corroborates management's assertions. Management has made some assertions when management has prepared the financial statement. So the evidences might be supporting to that, or might be corroborating to that. Or it also includes, that means audit evidences also includes those evidences which contradicts the assertions. If there is some contradiction and some evidences shows that contradiction, that is also an audit evidence. Management is saying this much is receivable from this entity, but entity is saying nothing is payable by me. Okay, and that entity has given a letter that nothing is payable to you. So that letter is an audit evidence which contradicts management's assertions. Management assertion is that money is receivable. Management is recognizing. But evidence shows no. Evidence is giving a contradictory thing. It's saying no, nothing is payable. That letter also forms a part of audit evidence. And sometimes what happens, absence of information is also an audit evidence. Okay, you have asked for clarifications. Let us say, auditor has asked for certain clarifications and management has refused. Auditor has asked for certain information, management has refused to give it. So here what happens, this absence of information is also an audit evidence. Auditor can record those evidence, and on that basis, auditor can form a judgment. Hope you are getting me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you see, topic is a little technical, so you have to listen carefully. Now, there is one more standard, which is SA 200. The title of the standard is Overall Objectives of the Independent Auditor and the Conduct of Audit in Accordance with Standards of Auditing. And this standard says reasonable assurance is obtained when auditor has obtained sufficient appropriate audit evidence to reduce audit risk to an acceptably low level. Friends, you need to understand this particular sentence. As I told you, or as we are discussing right now, it is extremely important for the auditor to collect audit evidence. Okay, audit evidences has to be collected. On that basis, he has to draw a conclusion. Okay, and here we are learning that reasonable assurance is obtained. Okay, the reasonable assurance that the financial statement is showing it true and fair, it can be obtained when auditor has obtained sufficient appropriate audit evidence. If evidence is there, then only auditor can obtain reasonable assurance. Without any evidence, a reasonable assurance cannot be obtained. Okay. And again, if you read it, reasonable assurance is obtained when auditor has obtained sufficient appropriate audit evidence to reduce the audit risk to an acceptably low level. The concept of audit risk at a very basic level, we need to understand that. And what is expected in every audit situation, auditor is expected to bring the audit risk to a acceptably low level. He has to bring it to a acceptable level. And what is that audit risk? Audit risk is explained in the next point. You can read it. It's the risk that the auditor expresses an inappropriate opinion when financial statements are materially misstated. That means financial statements are materially misstated and auditor is giving a report which is not warranted. That means auditor is supposed to, let us say, give a qualified report, or he is supposed to give a adverse report, but instead auditor has given a clean report. So that is the audit risk. Again, I repeat, it is the risk that auditor expresses an inappropriate opinion when financial statements are materially misstated. Misstatement is material, and auditor is giving an inappropriate opinion. If that is so, we can say there is an audit risk. If that possibility is there, you can say audit risk is high. So auditor has to collect evidences to reduce that audit risk to an acceptably low level. He has to perform all these audit procedures in such a way that audit risk is brought to a low level. Okay. Therefore, audit evidences are important. And not only audit evidences, both evidences which are sufficient and evidences which are appropriate. Therefore, it is said that sufficient appropriate audit evidences are needed. And friends, you will definitely appreciate that the terms sufficient and appropriateness are interrelated. As you know, sufficiency is the measure of quantity, and appropriateness is the measure of quality, or you can say relevance. And this quantity of audit evidences is affected by the auditor's assessment of risk of misstatement, and also the quality of such audit evidences. If quality of evidences is very good, then with less quantity, auditor may be satisfied. Okay, let us say evidences that auditor is collecting, they're externally collected. They're not coming through client. It is directly coming to the auditor. That means they're more reliable, you can say. External evidences are always more reliable or better than internal evidences. Is it not? So quality is better. External evidences, quality is better. So if more external evidences are there, or let's say internal control system is also good, then auditor might compromise with quantity. With less quantity, he may be satisfied. Okay? But in case, let us say quality is poor, the quality of audit evidence is poor, then auditor may require additional evidences. More evidences might be required by the auditor. Did you understand? And also, we need to appreciate, the higher the assessed risk, more audit evidences is likely to be required. If audit risk is high, then one will be requiring more audit evidences. And higher the quality, less evidences will be required. Okay. I think you have understood this. Quality more, less evidences are required. Okay. But that does not mean that obtaining more audit evidences, however, may not compensate for poor quality. So that is, the quality of evidence is very poor. That doesn't mean that you can compensate this by collecting more evidences. No, may not be. Ultimately, you have to draw reasonable conclusions. And evidence should be sufficient as well as appropriate. So both quantity as well as quality plays an important role. Auditor has to, depending upon the facts and circumstances, auditor has to make judgment that how many evidences, what kind of evidences will be appropriate in this case. Okay. Okay, friends. Is it clear up to this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we'll do one thing, friends. We'll take a quick break here.